Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to welcome you and everyone joining us online to this opening concert in our 2023-24 season. My name is Joyce Ritchie, and I'm the Vice President of the Governing Board of Community Concerts at Second. This marks our 37th year of presenting Music for All, Free to All. And it's going to be a terrific season. I hope you've had a chance to look through the brochure. Our afternoon concerts include performances by flutist Adam Sadbury, cellist Amit Peled, with pianist Solomon Eichner, organist Nathaniel Gums, the Grammy-nominated Hub New Music, Fidelio Trio, and the world-famous vocalist Denise Graves. This year's Chamber Music by Candlelight concerts combine new and adventurous music by living composers with favorite works by Mozart, Beethoven, Brahms, Debussy, Schubert, and more. How is all this possible? Well, it's our mission at Community Concerts at Second to offer world-class performances, music for all, free to all, but they are not free to produce. As an independent nonprofit organization, Community Concerts depends on the generosity of our funders and friends. Today's concert and this season is made possible by grants from the National Endowment for the Arts, the Maryland State Arts Council, some private foundations, and generous gifts from individuals in our audience and community. You. If you've already made a gift this season, we say thank you. We're deeply grateful. If you've not yet had a chance to make a gift, please consider doing so while you're here today or anytime online at our website or through our mobile giving portal. Details are in the program book. Also in the program book is a brief survey that we hope you will fill out. And if you haven't already handed it in, please do so on your way out. And last but certainly not least, as we settle into today's concert, we want to recognize another indispensable partner to Community Concerts, the congregation here at Second Presbyterian Church. Thank you, Second Presbyterian, for this acoustically beautiful space and for being such a terrific partner for 37 years of music making. Now, please take a moment to silence your cell phones and other electronic devices. Thank you. And now please join me in giving a warm welcome to pianist Benjamin Pasternack.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I have a quick announcement. There's a white Honda Civic parked with Pennsylvania plates parked in front of someone's driveway, and it does need to be moved. Again, there's a white Honda Civic parked in front of someone's driveway. It has Pennsylvania plates, and it would be so kind if you all could move that so our neighbors could get into their homes. Thank you so much. Hi, folks. One more time, just if the owner of the white Honda Civic could move the car with Pennsylvania plates. I don't know if you moved it yet or anything, but I just wanted to put that announcement out again. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm going to speak about the pieces on the second half, but before I do, I want to maybe, well, express my satisfaction, happiness to be here. It's really great. And especially a special appreciation for the audience, of course. And I want to thank two people. One, I don't know if he's here, as Dr. Bernard Lieberman, two people who helped me to prepare today. A true music lover. And the second is Mary Schwendeman, who prepared the pianos. You know, when I was probably, 18, I had long train rides sometimes from Philadelphia to New York with Felix Gallimere, who was a great old musician at the time. And once I remember telling him that I was so fortunate to have studied with so many great artists, and I sort of listed them. And there was a pause. And then he said, well, I can't do his accent, sorry. If you don't turn out good, it's your own fault. So that's sort of how it is when Mary prepared the pianos. If I don't sound good, it's my own fault. You can see probably the program for the second half is three pieces with a connection to Hungarian music. Kodály wrote MAROSSZÉK dances in 1920-something, and MAROSSZÉK is apparently an actual town in Hungary where that was famous for excellent music and dancing back generations, hundreds of years. And he loved to go out and collect these things and use them as an inspiration. To what extent the dances are actually folk dances and or are actually composed by Kodály, I'm not sure. But they sound like both. Folk dances composed by a genius. But actually the piece itself is not just dances. He did something really nice. He wrote a beautiful long melody which puts you in the mood. And then comes the first dance. Then the melody comes back in a completely different character. And then comes second dance episode. All this is streaming together. There are no pauses. Then the tune comes back in a sort of mystical way, and a third dance, and the tune comes back in the most sort of beautiful, smooth way, and then the fourth liveliest dance.
Thank you.
Bartók was Kodály's great contemporary, and they were close friends. And he also was very fascinated by the concept of using Hungarian folk music as an inspiration. But in the suite I'm about to play, Bartók insisted that everything was his own. None of it was folk music, per se. But it often sounds like it. It's inspired by it. The suite is in four short movements. And it's a scheme which Bartók used a few times in his life, very modern, interesting. The first music is moderate tempo. The second is faster, a scherzo, or it sounds faster. The third, again, sounds faster. It's quite dramatic and wild. And then the fourth, last movement is very calm and slow. I literally knew someone who heard the piece is written around the end of World War I. And I literally knew a fine, great musician who heard this piece when it was brand new. Right after World War I, he told me. And he said, when the audience heard the fourth movement, they were absolutely shocked. And I still remember he said to me, it seemed like music from another planet. Thank you. Franz Liszt was also Hungarian, but several generations before those past two composers. Although it's sort of comical to read his life story and figure out how Hungarian was he. He was born in Hungary, his father was Hungarian, but he left very, very young, didn't remember it. His nanny who raised him didn't speak a word of Hungarian, and it's not clear how well he spoke Hungarian either. And he didn't spend too much time there throughout his life. However, he was extremely, he was very proud of being Hungarian and extremely influential in the growth of music in that country. And in certain ways, just like the famous Hungarian composers of the 20th century, Liszt went to folk music for models. So the what we call in English the Hungarian Rhapsodies are music that one way or another was inspired or derived from music from Hungary, but not of Hungarians exactly, music of the Hungarian, what they used to call gypsies, which we call today Roma or Romani. And they had their own extremely different and extremely well worked out way of playing music, and it drove some of the conventional composers crazy. They loved it, especially Liszt. He went nuts for it, and he went out all the time to hear them. He took down, copied down their best tunes and their style of playing, and so that's what you have. He wrote many of these Hungarian Rhapsodies, he called them. Some are a strict imitation of what that music sounded like. This one, number 12, it's much more developed by Liszt than it would be by a folk musician. But it still has the same feeling, the exaggeration, the style of different instruments, also the form where you have half the piece is sad with lots of different variations on that, and half the piece is happy with lots of different variations on that. And in fact, he does fantastic compositional thing here where he starts bringing all the tunes that he was using in the piece back at the end, including even the saddest one from the beginning, which he turns into sort of the ultimate triumph.